What's up, everybody? We are back with another episode of the Layer One Podcast. Keep up to date with us on Twitter at Layer One Pod. For those who haven't heard this podcast yet, we are talking all things Layer One in crypto, right? These are especially hot staking projects, the latest news, breaking or otherwise. We're getting a ton of content out there for you. Every Monday, we're doing Layer One Live now, where you can follow along with us live on YouTube, on Twitter, ask us all the questions you have about the market that we will certainly try to answer. We're even dabbling in some streaming stuff, and we always have a weekly podcast guest from a notable cryptocurrency project. So some exciting things happening over here at Layer One. Q, how you doing today?
I'm doing good, and you forgot to mention that we also do giveaways. I'm this Chill Jones guy over here, so I'm going to go ahead and chill away. But we are doing a giveaway one episode ago where we had you comment on the episode two times ago. So we're doing that giveaway. It was a $50 Harmony token. That is the one token giveaway if you commented on the Nick White podcast on our Twitter. So the winner of that giveaway was Blunt Crypto. So congratulations, Blunt Crypto. You won the giveaway. We're going to be doing these all the time, man. So we'll probably do these on a bi-weekly basis or two times a month. For those of you that don't know what bi-weekly is, which is, I don't know why I said that. But anyways, Blunt Crypto, congratulations on that. We had a good time on Layer One Live on Monday. Those are going to be around noon to 1 p.m. on Mondays if we can get it out and there's no issues. Sometimes we have different issues and we got to push it back to 3 or 4, but for the most part those will be released and live on Monday, and they live on our YouTube as well, so you can go back and check the recording there. We talk all things, like Mike said, Layer One protocols. I think we talked a lot about IOST, we talked a lot about IOST, there was a lot of Ethereum news on the last one, and I'm sure we'll get to the Lightning Network here with the questions that we had via the chat. So I'm excited, man. Lawrence was a great guest this week, though. What'd you think?
Yeah, I loved it. And I almost forgot Dimitri would kill us. But we also, for those of you traders or investors out there, have Dimitri's desk, which is definitely a unique piece of content. Dimitri, our partner in Layer One Live and in Sutler Ventures, basically every week breaks down Bitcoin, ETH, EOS, IOST, handful of different projects out there to kind of give you some technical analysis on what the charts are showing. So, you know, strictly from a trading standpoint, you know, not including fundamentals in that. And obviously it's not investment advice. He'll kind of keep you steady on these crazy volatile seas, if you will. So shout out Dima, shout out Dimitri there, but, yeah.
I've been telling him to change the name to How to Lose Crypto, but he won't. He just leaves it as Dimitri's desk.
He was hitting some there for a while. I haven't checked out the latest episode, but I know he was he was hitting him pretty square on. So shout out to Dimitri as always. But yeah, I love the podcast with Lawrence. You know, as some background that we talked about a little bit on the interview. You know, Sutler Ventures, the basically business behind the Layer One podcast. You know, it's interesting because IOST has basically been the first staking protocol that we've launched with. You know, the idea of Sutler Ventures is that we're kind of out there on the front lines with, you know, both the users, both the projects, applications that they're building on that Layer One, in this case IOST, in an effort to just kind of help it grow, right? We really like to contribute to communities, help them further decentralization, and IOST has been close to our heart for a long time now, well over a year or two. So, you know, it was great to have him on. You can kind of tell towards the end of the podcast, we were trying to push him for some big news. He does talk a little bit there about, you know, some interesting kind of exchange stuff, which is always hot on the minds of folks, especially with the new Binance US stuff and kind of new regulation hitting. So it was a great interview all the way through. You know, whether you're just hearing about IOST or you've been with IOST for some time through our podcast or whatever, it's good info from Lawrence.
Yeah, it was interesting to hear him talk about which Asian countries he thought were going to lead the charge in the various different regions there, as well as some of the hurdles that any protocol is going to have coming out the gate, what they thought, you know, what they wish they knew before they got into it. That was an interesting topic, but let's get into the episode, man. I know We got a lot of listeners ready to hear from Lawrence. So let's go.
Alrighty, guys, we are here with Lawrence Lim, head of business development for IOST. Obviously, you know, many of you out here have heard us talking about IOST before. The previous name of the podcast was the IOST podcast. It's a protocol we cover every week. So we are super excited to have Lawrence here to talk all things IOST. Lawrence, how are you?
Hey, guys. Good to see you here. Very good. It's nighttime over here in Singapore, and it's really amazing to be catching up with you guys over the podcast. I think it's been some time since an IOST member come on to the Sutler Ventures podcast. So really excited to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, essentially any and all layer one projects, especially those that are kind of under the radar or burgeoning, right, have some good momentum in this space, from creating a nice decentralized network, you know, building out a staking ecosystem. These are all projects that we like to cover. But IOST obviously has a special place in our heart. For those who don't know, Sutler Ventures, the company behind the Layer One podcast, is probably top 25 node, I think, right now on IOST, and we've been with these good folks for some time now. So anyway, let's hop right into it, Lawrence. You know, you have an interesting background, and it's always cool to hear kind of how people get to the wild world of crypto. So can you give us a brief background on kind of what brought you to IOST?
Yeah, definitely. So I started my career in banking over here in Singapore. I was with JP Morgan and American Bank in private banking. Spent 4 years across a few different functions, private banking, investment banking, and asset management. And subsequently, I moved into tech. So the first stop was a software as a service inventory management company called TradeGecko. It's funded by some of the sovereign wealth funds in Singapore. And you know, that was my first foray into tech. Not an easy transition from finance into tech, but you know, it went well. And then, you know, the next stop was actually I started getting into crypto a little bit because, you know, Bitcoin was making some headlines. I also got into a private investments into a crypto exchange over in Australia. And that's really when my interest in crypto peaked. And just happened right at the same time, IOST came calling. We had some good discussions. The co-founders are young, visionary, and they were building something very exciting. So I thought it's a really good space for me to mix my interest for finance and technology. And I think that's where blockchain really seeds, you know, making changes across the world in terms of financial transformation using technology. I think that really resonates with me coming from my background. So I decided to take the plunge 1.5 years, close to 2 years later, you know, I'm here with you guys.
That's awesome, man. As far as that finance background goes, what are some of the negatives and what are some of the positives of moving from finance to a more tech related, you know, kind of careers? What are some of the positives and negatives there?
Yeah, I think the key for me maybe is just about the transition from a very structured multinational companies into, you know, like less structured startups where you are really responsible for driving a lot of output. Previously, you can lean on your seniors. You're able to just say, hey, you know, there's someone who can solve these problems. And then when you get to startups, you suddenly realize that, oh no, you have to solve problems by yourself. So it's a very different mindset, but I think it's really good for me in terms of, you know, becoming independent, learning how to solve things, fix things, and you start to see the different problems that people face in business. Whereas you don't see that as much within a very corporate setting. So I think that was the biggest transition for me in that sense. I was in the sales team as well. So, you know, the banking skill sets actually translate pretty well over to sales in a tech startup. Being able to understand how businesses work and being able to solution, I think that is something that has helped me across my entire career.
Gotcha. Absolutely. Gotcha. Yeah, makes a ton of sense. We kind of, I've never been in the banking industry, but you know, we like to kind of imagine what that would be like versus obviously launching your own cryptocurrency tokens. Drastically different, but you know, a blast up to date so far, I'm sure, over the last 2 years for you and for IOST. So, you know, you're working in banking a little bit, you know, you move to the tech sector, then you, you know, you meet Jimmy, you meet Ray, you meet, you know, maybe saw some of the other co-founders. What was it that really got you interested in IOST? And, you know, did you guys, you know, was it kind of a long process or were you just immediately like, you know, this is it. I think this is a good next step for me.
Yeah. So we did have some discussions. Mainly it was remote, and yes, after that, you know, we had a couple of meetings after that. So the process took a little time, but I think the key thing that sort of stood out for me at the time was that, you know, the crypto world was booming. I was looking at Jimmy and I was looking at, you know, these guys are young, visionary. They have a lot of energy. They have secured funding from some of the top funds. I pretty much look at the funders, the investors behind the project, and you know, I think there's some real meat behind what's going on. And that's really one of the key things that convinced me to head over to IOST. I think the next thing is also at how organized they are and you know, how the process went. You know, we went really deep into discussions on to how IOST technology is, you know, how it's going to change the world, how we can create a different sort of financial environment as well as digital transformation for a lot of consumers. I think that was really exciting for me. And then, you know, after we sort of sorted out, get a good feeling of each other, and then that's when we committed into joining the team and hopefully, you know, grow the IOST community.
Yeah. So as far as the IOST's background, for those that haven't heard of IOST before that are interested in other protocols, or maybe they're, you know, users of those networks, what is IOST? And kind of for the people that do understand IOST and have been following, what's the way forward for IOST within the next 6 months to a year?
Yeah, that's a great question. And really to answer that very specifically, I think since the mainnet launch, there has always been a few key priorities that we have been looking at. I would be there's three. So the first one would be for us to bring in more user adoption. That has always been key. And how we are doing that is we are doing marketing for the IOST token as well as for applications built on IOST. We are very aggressive on that. We are building up the ecosystem as well as bringing new users into using all these apps. And then the second thing that we are looking at is also bringing in more nodes, because ultimately IOST is a public blockchain. The foundation helps to give the first push for the community to move forward. But ultimately, at some point, you know, the nodes, the community users themselves should be in charge and running the network. And you know, nodes would be sort of like leaders, community leaders within the ecosystem to bring in more users, more dApps, and ultimately create a sort of momentum forward for the project. So this has been two key priorities. And the third one, which we have always been trying to be different, is also about decentralization. And one thing that we have looked at, we realized about proof of stake protocols, is that there's a lot of centralization within the projects. We have, you know, besides proof of believability, which allow us to make the network open for more nodes to participate. I think right now there's easily 50, 60 nodes doing block production on IOST, which is a very high number compared to the other proof of stake protocols. One thing that we are also looking at is to democratize the process. And that's not an easy task, because ultimately, you know, handing the reins of things over to the community is, you know, you need a well-structured program, you need a well-structured governance structure. So that's taking us a little time, but I think, you know, one thing that we have been, I believe, progressing well on that would be with the IOST Global Alliance, which is led by your team, along with the other nodes, to really look into how this can be done, have a sandbox environment where we can do things, and then, you know, really implement it for the entire community going forward.
Yeah, it's certainly an exciting time for governance, right? Decentralization, I think, is a hot topic. I think a lot of people kind of sell decentralization as a big thing, but once a lot of community members or users realize truly what it is, it can be scary. So, you know, having that governance model is super key, just to make sure that incentives are aligned and users are understood of kind of where the project is headed next. So, you know, we see some governance kind of issues that look like they're being resolved with EOS, and You know, there's obviously been some stuff with Tron and their staking with Binance. So it's an interesting world, and we'll obviously keep everybody posted from a governance standpoint with IOST. You know, you talked a bit about dApps coming on to IOST. Obviously, kind of the number of dApps out there, or certainly the quality of dApps out there, are low. I think that probably has to do with the number of developers that are available out there. You know, there's really, even today, not a ton of blockchain developers relative to, you know, what you would just see in the form of software developers globally. What are some of the efforts, or what are some of the things that IOST is doing to try to attract some of these new developers, try to attract some of these new dApps or nodes into the ecosystem?
Yeah, I think you hit it right on the head about blockchain still being very early stage. There's not a lot of developers who have that level of blockchain experience to create things, build things. And what we are seeing now is that there needs to be some accumulation in terms of experience, in terms of applications being iterated multiple times to become a fully polished product. So I think we just need a little time for all this to get into the right momentum for the entire industry. So for IOST specifically, what we have been looking to do is to focus on education in terms of developers. So that's one. And the second one is to bring existing blockchain applications and developer teams onto IOST. So the first one, education has always been there. We have a Slack group where people can reach out directly to our tech team to ask questions. We do events like hackathons in various countries, Singapore, Japan, Korea, and I believe even in the US, Russia, we are looking at doing some of these things. In particular, for I think just recently, BlockDevs Asia, one of our nodes, have released an IOST champ, which is a crash course on IOST for blockchain developers or even other developers who wants to develop blockchain, you know, just for them to get their hands dirty on IOST. We have also been discussing with BlockDevs Asia about pushing on something which is really a full-fledged education engine where, you know, there's structured courses, and then we bring it to different universities, to different developer groups, different developer academies to help them get in, you know, really firstly have the blockchain education, and secondly have IOST as their first touch point on blockchain education. And then for the second one, which is the working with existing developers, one thing that we have been doing is always developer outreach to existing DApps that have been doing, you know, that have built on other chains, and helping them to launch their version on IOST. So that's really a quick win for us. We have done that successfully for quite a number of DApps, and that's why, you know, over the last few months, you have seen the number of tokens and the number of smart contracts on IOST growing quite a bit. One other thing that we have also been doing is that we have funded some DApp teams who are, you know, building applications that is consumer facing and being able to bring users. So some of this fundings have already been done, and we are just waiting for the DApps to come online.
So IOST launched, I believe, in March of 2019, which actually, believe it or not, makes it one of the older networks within our industry. So I wanted to know, since you've been there for a long time, and we've interviewed other protocols on this podcast, but those are pretty nascent as well, if not, haven't even launched yet. So what are something, can you let the listener know, like, what is something you guys wish you knew when you first started? What is the biggest roadblock that you guys just didn't see in your way in launching a decentralized network?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the roadblocks that we have seen is really, I would call it, maybe we actually think that, you know, we are a bit slow, even though we launched a mainnet like half a year ahead. yeah, because I think there was a lot of focus on technology. We had built the white paper. I think, you know, between launching the token to launching the mainnet, it took about 15 months. I think that's a reasonable amount of time. But, you know, if we are able, but I think it's really sometimes about market timing. If we had knew that, you know, the market would have changed so quickly, you know, a faster launch, would have been better, but you know, compromising on tech is always not the best option. So it's a bit of a juggle, right? Commercial versus technology. If possible, I think a faster launch to market would have allowed us to catch to reach a bigger catchment of users who were there at that point. You know, things can be changed, but I think, you know, we were doing pretty well so far in terms of being able to attract new users to the network. I think it's still about education, helping them to understand why IOST is different from many of the protocols and what are the sort of benefits that they can find with the community.
Yeah, you guys are definitely one of the fastest teams out there. So I know hindsight's 2020, but 15 months for a token and the whole mainnet, launching the network, right? There's a lot that goes into it behind the scenes, on the front line. So yeah, I mean, you know, we've been super happy, obviously, since mainnet launch. Certainly price is not where anybody wants it right now, but as you said, market timing can certainly be tough. So, you know, to date, IOST, you know, we're here, there's hundreds of different nodes out there. There's dozens of dApps. Users are increasing every day. Transaction count is very high, and general accounts are continually increasing. Essentially, the network is growing and growing and growing, right? We obviously, the goal is to be in a position where as more general users and investors come into crypto, come into blockchain, that IOST is poised to be a big net for them. But outside of the network, right, kind of the ecosystem itself, I think there's a lot that people don't know kind of about the underlying tech of IOST. And we're not tech guys, so we're not talking, you know, anything super detailed here. But, you know, one of the biggest things for me when looking at IOST back in the day for the first time was the proof of believability setup and the contribution rewards. Can you talk to us just a little bit and kind of broadly about what those two things are and why that makes IOST different?
Sure. Yeah. And I got a lot of questions about how proof of believability, POB, really works for, compared, how it really differs compared to other proof of stake protocols. And I think if I can just give a very summarized layman version, is that we have an algorithm that allow a big pool of block producers to be rotated in for block production in fixed intervals. Which means that across these different fixed intervals, the block producers, the group, the community of block producers are always different, which creates a more decentralized network compared to other proof of stake protocols that doesn't do rotation, and therefore it typically stays within a very controlled group. So I think that is the key thing that creates decentralization for us in terms of, you know, spreading out the power among a larger group of block producers and creating that sort of democratic system, which I would say put us on a higher scale on the decentralization scale. Yeah. So I think right from the beginning, we have always placed decentralization as one of our key priorities. We all know that the crypto community, a good portion are financial investors who are looking for prices, but we genuinely believe that there's also a group who wants to see blockchain and crypto really changing the world and how it works. So, you know, I think really for this group of people, they want to see decentralization, they want to see their voice, they want to see their voice being heard. And that's really the whole point of public blockchains, public projects. I think decentralization has always been a core part. And I think whatever we do, we always consider what the community wants, what the users would think, even as one of the smallest users within IOST.
Yeah, so Mike talked on the contribution report, and certainly that is one that gets a lot of comments from the community when it gets dropped every quarter. But that's actually some breaking news. We just had you guys just put out the contribution report for quarter three. It's really a big tug of war between decentralization and centralization and the benefits of both, right? Just in the terms of blockchain and cryptocurrency in general. And actually, the contribution report is kind of a centralized process, let's be honest. And you guys have plans to make it more decentralized in the future, but it's actually something that I like right now that you guys do, because it reward what we're seeing on other protocols is the exchanges are taking over proof of stake essentially, and they're gaining the rewards from the community. They're giving it back, so they're getting more rewards. It's like a big snowball that's getting pushed downhill. So can you explain that contribution report and tell us how that process went this quarter?
Sure. So the contribution reports, I think, is something that is very specific to IOST. As far as I understand, that's not another protocol doing it, or I'm not aware of. So in a nutshell, how contribution rewards work is that every quarter, all the nodes would submit a contribution report to the IOST Foundation, and together with the ICAC, which is an independent arbitration community for the IOST community. So what we do is that we'll evaluate these contribution reports and score them in terms of basically five tiers of how much this report, how much these contributions have added value to the ecosystem. So I think that's, of course, you know, quite a time-consuming process when you receive like 100 reports and you have to look through every single one of them. Definitely the challenge as well is also that some of this, you know, there's different activities being done. Some people focus on integrations, some people focus on events, some people focus on marketing and promotion. So when all of this come together, actually it creates a very potent mix. But you know, when it comes to evaluating reports, it's really apples to oranges. So it's also one of our tasks to really try to make this a fair and you know, fair process for everyone, because everyone's efforts are really being valued by the foundation as well as the community. I would say the interesting thing about this contribution reward is that all the nodes within, say, tier one are given the same amount. So it doesn't matter how much of the votes you have received. For example, you can have like 30% of the network votes, but you get the same as someone who has 5% if both of you are scored same as tier one. And it gives an opportunity for smaller nodes to be able to get the same sort of rewards that larger nodes can get. And I think, you know, this sort of creates an equalizer where, you know, it's not about just about the rich getting richer, but about giving some sort of meritocratic returns to contribution.
Right.
Yeah, and you don't see that on other protocols. There's a bunch of complaints of people that are doing a ton of good work on some other networks that aren't getting rewarded in kind, and I think that's a great process. But Mike, go ahead. I you have a question?
Yeah, no, I mean, I just wanted to kind of add some context to that as well. You know, as Sutler Ventures has been a node from the start with mainnet. I mean, you know, the network evolves over time, right? I think we launched with maybe a little over 100 nodes, and now we're well into multi-hundreds. And you know, IOST is not they're not special in that, you know, you do still see exchanges voting, right, for IOST. Obviously, you know, the network has done well. Exchanges are a business. They're and many times a community member in a lot of senses as well. You know, these exchanges are working with IOST, working with various protocols to help the network forward. But as you said, Q, you know, whether it's a delegated proof of stake or just pure proof of stake, the kind of the balance between larger organizations and smaller community members or smaller nodes and everybody being incentivized or rewarded equally is a super tough balance. So, you know, I remember at the launch of mainnet, we were talking about this interesting kind of game theoretical approach where as a user, as an investor, as somebody who, you know, could go out and buy some IOST, they themselves from a reward standpoint, if you include the daily staking rewards that you receive, and you also include the quarterly contribution rewards that we're talking about here, as a user, as an investor, as someone who is holding and staking this IOST, you will actually, in many cases, earn more by voting for the smaller nodes who essentially you will make up a larger vote of, right? So if a smaller node has 2.5 million IOST voted to it, but you make up 1 million of those IOST, right? You're making up 40% of the total vote there. Meaning that, you know, as the contribution rewards come out, if this node is helping IOST is helping the community, you're going to get a larger chunk than if you put that 1 million towards a much larger top five, top 10 node where you're not going to amount to 40% of the vote. It's going to be much smaller. So I know we've been playing with that. Our node rank has been going up and down, and a lot of users have as well, but it's a super interesting note there. I want to talk a little bit, because you're obviously over in Singapore. Obviously IOST has had a focus on China, Japan, Singapore, had some outreach in Vietnam, and really, you know, broadly Asia has been the focus. But before we take a break and talk a little bit more kind of about price and future of IOST, Lawrence, can you give us some insight? Can you give some of the Western audience who maybe have never traveled to Asia before, interacted with kind of the Asian cryptocurrency market? What's the latest over there? Are people bullish? Are they bearish? You know, what's the feel over there right now for crypto in general?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think one thing that I would say over here, people are still very, very bullish. In fact, I think especially in Southeast Asia, there has been a lot of new interest, partly because actually they missed the entire wave, the boom and the bust. So they missed the bust as well. So in terms of education, in terms of emotions, they are fairly new and very willing to explore. And I think the potential for blockchain over in Southeast Asia is actually very significant. There's a good portion who are unbanked. There's a good portion who hasn't been exposed to, say, legacy systems. So they are very open to new things that's being launched, being built. And that includes blockchain, includes crypto. And I would think in terms of regulations, Asia itself has been quite progressive and open-minded about regulations. Say, for example, Thailand, Philippines, to a lesser extent, Singapore, Malaysia, have all put in place some regulations or another to define how crypto trading should be. And most of it has been fairly open-minded, which means that people get access. There's licenses to make sure that there's the retail consumer is protected, and all these sort of measures to really help to open up. So I would say in terms of Asia, that's pretty significant potential. And China obviously is huge. There's a good population who are interested in how blockchain can play a role for them. Of course, the regulations within China itself are still in progress. Korea has been massive in terms of the reception to crypto. So Japan as well, there's been regulations, and just very recently they have started looking into accepting new coins to be regulated and open for trading by Japanese investors. So, that's one of the key things that's happening. And we also want to be there. I think the whole environment is shaping out pretty nicely for everyone, regulators, projects, users, and, people who can benefit from the use of crypto and blockchain.
I liked the regulation aspect as far as what Malta and the smaller islands were doing and how fast they were moving, but it definitely seems like the East is doing it in a more structured way. They're kind of mixing or having a good balance of being very structured, but also having the regulation, whereas it seems like countries like Malta and a couple of these other islands, it's like, you guys are moving way too fast. I get what you're trying to do and attract people to the country, but there needs to be some structure around this as well. So big companies, let's talk. Ev always told me, so Amazon of China, it's Tongbao. What is it? Do you know?
Which one?
There's like an Amazon version of in China. It's something that ends in Bao.
Taobao, right?
Taobao. So yeah, Taobao. WeChat, there's other companies like Alipay. Are these going to evolve and add cryptocurrencies in the future? And do you see them adding their own tokens, or do you see an opportunity for networks right now that have their own tokens to be integrated into these larger platforms?
Yeah, I think for China, a lot of the directives is actually state-led, country-led. So as to how this big companies, and I think they have some for them, which comprises of the Alibaba, Tencent, you know, all these big players. I think they would do things together with the government. So actually, if you just look at it, digital payments is already existing in terms of Alipay, in terms of Tencent, instead of the WeChat Pay. So digitalization of currency is actually nothing new to the country. I think the key thing is really just about keeping the sovereignty of the currency. So anything that I don't think they would go out to do something by themselves, but they would do so together with what the government has directed. And you know, I think that's really sort of just keeping things in control so that things don't get too far out of the way. Yeah,
absolutely, man. So last question before, at least for me on a regional perspective, you talked about integrating or trying to get IOST involved in the universities in each of these countries or some of them. What is the, which country are you most bullish on with as it relates to cryptocurrency? Is it a country like Korea? Is it Singapore? Is it Japan? What has been the most accepting? Where do you see crypto really exploding if you had to choose one?
Yeah, so I would say in just an Asian context, I mean, of course, you know, the American market is really huge. The purchasing power is huge over there. It's just that maybe in terms of regulations, it's still getting worked out. And that's actually, to a certain extent, I feel like, you know, people are already well-served with existing solutions that, you know, it's taking them longer to move to really new ones like blockchain and crypto. So, you know, when you have credit cards, like you don't really feel the need for all this, you know, alternative financial modes of payment. So I think, you know, at least within Asian context, you know, China has always been huge, despite obviously some regulations, the population makes, and the risk appetite of the population makes it extremely attractive.
Wait, break that down for a second. What do you mean by that? What do you mean by that appetite?
By risk appetite, I would say I think the Chinese have, you know, are willing to take risks. I think that's how it is within a huge population where there's massive competition in terms of business, in terms of commerce, in terms of in terms of being seen. When you launch things, you can see that, you know, they have the willingness to take risks on new things. And you know, for, you know, high risk, high returns, that sort of profile. So I think, you know, with that huge population and a very, you know, I would call it high risk acceptance profile, you know, willingness to try new things. You know, if you just look at it, China is still one of the largest crypto holders in the world, despite the government banning Bitcoin.
Yeah, great point.
Yeah. And then, you know, in Korea, definitely as well. Korea is huge, and you know, crypto interest there is still very active, despite, you know, how the market has changed over the past 1 year. Japan has the potential. I think it hasn't been as hot as how it had evolved in, say, China and Korea, but because the government is stepping in and allowing things to be traded, certain tokens to be traded, then we are looking at a sort of opening up of the market. So that's interesting. In particular, I would say in Southeast Asia, Vietnam has sort of led the region. So I think they have been one of the most progressive, and you know, the interest for crypto and how it can really transform how things work over in the country, whether, you know, is in terms of payments, is in terms of how businesses interact with each other. It has, you know, huge potential. And, you know, I think one thing about Southeast Asia has always been that the penetration of financial services is extremely low for the entire, you know, Southeast Asia region. Singapore is actually a bit of an anomaly given how much financial services has penetrated, but, you know, in the general region itself is actually extremely low. And if crypto is able to come out with a good use case and more stable values, and, you know, it can really just turn into the new thing where people just transact between each other without the need for centralized systems to exist.
Got it. Yeah, it's a certainly an exciting time to be in crypto, and it sounds like it is over there as well. So kind of taking a transition back to IOST a little bit here. We talked about this on our Layer 1 Live on Monday. So it seems like if you look out into the crypto landscape, there's a lot of competition for IOST, right? Whether it's EOS or Tron, obviously Ethereum's been there for a long time. We seem to notice a trend in these Layer 1 protocols who are kind of using what we would call like a beacon dApp, right? Or a really kind of major application layer project to attract new users to the protocol. Whereas, maybe 2-3 years ago, the goal was almost solely infrastructure, right? So we seem to kind of be moving maybe just a little bit from that infrastructure phase into now the really user-focused phase. And IOST has done some interesting things. You know, it seems from our perspective that IOST does a really good job of kind of splitting up resources across various projects. I think OnBlock and Emoji, right, or what was formerly Berm, are two good examples. For those who aren't aware of those two projects, especially Berm, which, you know, we obviously see as the as kind of the beacon dApp, right, the flagship application for IOST. What are those and kind of what has the growth looked like for those two projects?
Yeah, so I think so far, I think firstly, you're right. I think we have been looking specifically to some, like what you call beacon dApps to really bring the sort of user adoption to IOST. And I think you also rightly called out Emoji as well as OnBlock as the two sort of leaders for us. So I think the first thing is about Emoji. There's a focus on South America. So, you know, over there, the using content as well as cryptocurrency rewards, the user acquisition has been phenomenal. I think we are already past 6 million users and still growing very fast. And I think, you know, there's also talk of the token, which is LOL, to become a form of payments within Southern America. So I think, you know, they have done really well in terms of that penetration. I think it's due to some really good focus by the team. The Emoji team is actually separate from the IOST team, but we do look to see how we can support each other where necessary. And I think IOST token holders and IOST voters also receive LOL token airdrops for the next 5 years. So I think there's some synergies there in terms of rewards, bringing users into the system. LOL is built on IOST and the token is issued on IOST. So this hopefully with that sort of B2C level of penetration within South America, we'll be able to really onboard, you know, millions of users onto IOST as well.
Go ahead.
Yeah, and I think, you know, just on OnBlock, they actually also provide the other piece of the puzzle where, you know, there's an exchange for tokens launched on IOST. There's a way for users to actually just purchase IOST and start experiencing the apps. So it kind of just forms into a nice circle where, you know, if people receive IOST tokens, it's not just about holding it, it's not just about payments, they can use it to experience the apps as well.
How did you guys go about getting Emoji on the IOST network? Was that developed internally as separate teams, as Mike is saying? And how did you go about, how did it get as popular as it did, basically? That's my question.
Yeah, I think it's really about, I think over our chat with the Emoji team, what I understand is that because they give out the it's really a community project. Back to the same thing about blockchain, how blockchain started. People realize that they are able to receive rewards for their activities, and then they will be able to take these tokens and then, you know, sell it. And then whereas, you know, maybe say other people who consume on the application will be able to buy these tokens to consume. So it creates a circular cycle backed by, you know, a pool of users, you know, which basically forms the backbone of the community on the application. So I think that has always been the the one word that really drive blockchain projects. And I think that's one thing that Emoji has done well to get that sort of user acquisition, scaling up the community within South America.
One thing I'm always interested in about, sorry for cutting you off, Mike, but one thing I'm super interested in is having these apps that are user facing that, that target non-crypto users, how that kind of flows back into the network and how do you get that trickle down effect from the app? Kind of like what Voice will look like once it's launched on EOS, of bringing in users and then having them come to maybe some other third party applications on the platform. Is there any plans in kind of funneling non-crypto users from Emoji to the IOST network?
Yeah, definitely. So that's being done as we speak. I think one of the key things that, you know, if we are a user from user perspective, they actually are to a certain extent blockchain agnostic, but they interact with the DApp. So, you know, by bringing on good DApps that make you just want to use it over and over again, that's actually the key for us in terms of getting that sort of users. And then for Boom, or Emoji now, is that what we are doing is that, you know, they would get LOL, but at the same time, you know, we'll allow them to do certain conversions, allow them to be able to interact with the IOST token as well. So, and then, you know, these users would start creating wallets on IOST, and then, you know, they would also start, it's all about, I would call it familiarity and education, you know, starting with LOL, getting their first step into, oh, it's crypto, it's digital currency. And then you see IOST, oh, that's not just one crypto, there's others. And then they start to, you know, get in learning about crypto and how it can change things. And, you know, basically having that sort of user journey, starting from not knowing crypto to knowing LOL, to knowing IOST, creating wallets on IOST, using other applications on IOST. And you know, all this would just form into one chain.
Yeah, it's kind of an interesting world we're moving into, right? Where I feel like, you know, maybe 2-3 years ago, a lot of what you would call, you know, crypto investing or kind of anyone who is interested in the space, it was very focused on hype, right? It was very focused on marketing in the sense that, as you kind of see in the U.S. with the presidential elections. Or various kind of geopolitical events, one tweet could, you know, send a token price skyrocketing, right? And we don't see that as much anymore. I think as projects have evolved and kind of those who were solely focused on hype and didn't really have any tangible value have kind of disappeared, right? Project teams have moved on or whatnot. Whereas those who have the strong tech have been able to implement use cases. You know, they've done a good job even with the price going down of hanging around and increasing that use case. You know, it can certainly be difficult, I'm sure, for crypto networks, for cryptocurrency teams to kind of see their internal token bankroll vary so widely, you know, wildly. I mean, I think that the high on IOST token price back when it was an ERC-20 token was almost 10 cents, right? And now we see it where it is today, a little less than half a penny. So, you know, it's just kind of on your points of Emoji and bringing users in, that certainly seems to be the next frontier, you know, of user acquisition and a focus on quality versus hype. So, you know, I want to talk a little bit about, you know, kind of how IOST views token price versus, you know, the inherent tech, right? I mean, one of the things we talk about on the podcast a lot is that, you know, obviously there are very volatile cycles within cryptocurrency, right? You have what people will call bearish markets and bullish markets, meaning, you know, when it's bullish, the price is obviously looking up. There's a lot of positivity in the market. And when we kind of go through these bearish market cycles, there's a lot of negativity, right? Maybe people kind of purchase cryptocurrency tokens at the top, right as they got in, you know, didn't kind of educate themselves, and you need kind of this washing out of users or investors and certainly projects as well. So, you know, just kind of in general, right, with where IOST is today, from a pricing standpoint, but also a fundamental standpoint, you know, is there kind of some good thoughts that you can give the community out there who have been holding the token since a penny or a penny and a half and kind of see it where it is now?
Yeah, 100%. So I think And this is really just how the financial markets are. I think if you look at how the crypto markets prices have gone, it has pretty much tracked the how the boom and bust of the tech market as well in like 2000. So pretty much we see that huge hype went up, and then you know it came down. There was a little bit of a revival, but it was just a pop. And then you know now we are back at the stage where we are really have to build valuable products for people. So, and I can understand why you know investors, people who have gone to crypto during this period have felt negative. Nobody likes losing money. It's just normal. Whether it's stocks, whether it's commodities, forex, crypto, no one likes losing money. So I think, you know, for the investors who have came in at the wrong timing, unfortunately, there were some losses. You know, I think in terms of being a project, it is just cycles that we have to ride through, because sentiment, investor sentiment is just sort of, and especially with that sort of boom and bust, is actually quite disconnected from real economic value that's being created. So I think right now what we are focusing on, and I think that has always been one of our focus, is to create that sort of economic value and that sort of economic cycle for the IOST token. And how can this be done is really to create that sort of circulating economy. Because ultimately, if you look at the IOST token, it's about utility. And what is utility? Utility is about being, you know, it's about people buying and selling in the usage of some things. And for example, a Dapp. Someone buys, let's say, a trading card on the Dapp, and then you know somebody else will be willing to pay IOST to purchase it from the person, you know, at some point, or even to own a particular character. And then if you are the project team, the company behind running the Dapp, you actually receive your earnings in IOST tokens, and then you sell it to the open market to fund your project, right? And all this just creates like a circulating economy. And ultimately, for a project to truly have utility, we need users. We need projects coming together and, you know, at enough scale to create that sort of flowing economy. So I think it's not an easy thing. We are actually going down the hard route, because I think that's sustainable. Ultimately, hype can only last for a while, but if you are able to create this sort of circular economy happening with enough scale, then the token value will constantly, will definitely be sustainable and will constantly go up as more users, as the network grows.
Absolutely. I think those are great insights as we cap off the episode here. Mike, did you have any more questions before Lawrence tells the listeners where they can find about IOST, about himself, as we end?
Yeah, for sure. One final question. And Lawrence, obviously, you're always welcome, right? We'd love to have you back. I think we could talk here for hours. But, you know, as we kind of look out into the future here, 6-12 months from now, you know, whether it's somebody who's been holding IOST for a long time, or it's somebody who's maybe just hearing about IOST on this podcast, what can we expect in the future from IOST? We had a great call with you last week. Some awesome kind of insights and up and coming news there. I'm not sure what you're able to announce yet, but you know, what are some exciting things coming kind of 6-12 months, 3 months down the road?
Yeah, so I think for our existing community members in particular, you know, I think a lot of them has been supporting IOST for a long time. The market has came down, but you know, let's all be patient and let's all believe in the long term vision of where you know, crypto and IOST can go. I think that's important. Probably, you know, the time to, you know, having the $1 IOST may take longer than I expect, but you know. But it will come earlier than you think. So I think, you know, we all need to be patient and just know that you know, at some point the value will come. It's just about accumulation across the world and you know, having the entire industry and user and the general public learning about how it can really change things. So while the education is going, you know, let's be patient and stay strong. And you know, especially for IOST itself, you know, the team is working hard. There has been, you know, we are working on several, I would call it, long-term collaborations, you know, big collaborations, in particular Japan, career that, you know, some of the things that I talked about before is actually underway during the podcast. In particular for sort of, for exchanges, we are always working very closely with them. And I would say that, the exchanges that we should be on, what will definitely be there is we are sort of working out some of the details. So in terms of staking, you will see, a major exchange coming on board very soon. And as well as, some new marketing and promotions being done.
I see you juggling what you can and can't say right now. It's visible.
Yeah, because just wanting to not overstab.
Sure.
Yeah, but beyond that, we have always. I think one thing is clear. As you can see from our announcements, there's always something new being announced every week. Whether it is a new tool for developers, whether it is a new partnership, whether it is a new node coming on board. We are pushing forward on all cylinders on all fronts, and just making sure that the ecosystem grows well across all areas. So we can always do better, and we want to do better, and we want our community to trust us, and have this sort of confidence that we are going to do our best for them.
Got it. Yeah, love it. Broadly, I think we're all excited for the fundamentals that we see, right? The growth that IOST has had, kind of that very steady push forward, whether it's partnerships like the Just Co launch, in kind of the co-working space, plus IOST developer collaboration that we see here, or it's things small, right? Like education from various nodes, or even just this podcast, right? So as Lauren said, hang in there, guys. We're kind of hopefully moving out of the bearish cycle here into a more bullish one. But Lawrence, it's been absolutely a pleasure. Obviously, we'll be talking more. But for those out there, if they're just hearing about IOST or if they want to follow you in general, what's the best way to do so?
Yeah, I think the best way to do so is to visit us at our website, iost.io. And to follow us on some of the news updates that we have. We release 3 to even 5 pieces on news, on how our ecosystem is growing, on how our what a new partnership is being announced. It's all on Medium. So you can go to medium.com/IOST. Otherwise, you'll be able to join our Telegram groups, you'll be able to find the links on our website or on our Medium is at official IOS. That's on Telegram, and I'm there as well in the group. So you can ping me directly in the group to get like answers and questions on IOST. We always want to make sure our community receives direct answers and be able to get in touch with the team.
Yeah, I saw you giving some direct answers this morning before the podcast. That was pretty funny. But I'll link all of those links that you just talked about in the description of the video below. But it was a great conversation as always, and we'd love to have you back sometime. I appreciate the time.
Yeah, thank you guys. It's a pleasure coming on to this podcast, and I also want to thank Sutler Ventures for being one of our early supporters and adding value to our ecosystem since the first day we launched our mainnet. And definitely is a pleasure being here, and we'll love to come on again, and look forward to more collaborations.
Absolutely. Thanks, Lawrence.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Zach.